I came back to Canada, and very soon, a few months later, I was appointed a member of the Anthropological Division of the National Museum, a new division to study the Indians of Canada. It was a new departure on the part, on behalf of the National Museum. Spring came 2 or 3 months after my appointment, and the question was, where shall I go to study Indians in Canada? Northwest Coast Indians, the Totem Indians. I had prepared a thesis at Oxford on this subject, and I was very partial to it. Yet my director said, why don't you go back to Indian Lorette, near your place of birth? And at once it appealed to me. I would go back and try and find out that old priest, Vincent, from whom I had heard my first Indian songs when I was a child. It quite appealed to me. So in the spring I packed up with a little Edison phonograph and went past Quebec to Lorette, 8 miles beyond on the hills. There I found people who were quite disappointing to me. I expected to see real Indians. They are not. They were not. Not one of them spoke Huron. They had all forgotten their language. They were like white people, except that they were grouped densely in a small patch of ground, a little village, Indian Lorette. Some of them, the women, made baskets or made embroidered moccasins and lived as they could. A few of them were still hunters and guide for hunters north in the forest north of Quebec. I inquired about priest Vincent, and they told me, yes, that he was still living, but he was aged, he was ill, and in an old man's home for priests near Quebec City. So I went to see him. The first conversation I had with him, he was most friendly and cordial. He called me Mon Petit Marius, as if I were still a boy at school. And then he was quite willing to sing me all the songs he knew. He was the last one in his tribe who had learned those songs from his elders, and they had been forgotten since by other members of the tribe. And it's then that I began to learn and make records on Edison phonographs. You know, the old machine, the Edison. Most of our collections have been made on wax records in that way. They are quite imperfect compared with the tape recordings of the present day, such as this. Well, what songs then? Well, there were so many of them. I reminded him of his song, Wainahe, Wainahe, Wainahe. And then he took a little Indian drum that he had there and began some sing. Wainahe, nahe, wainahe, nahe, wainahe, nahe, na yaho, ya wainahe yaho, ya wainahe, wainahe, nahe, na wainahe, na ya wainahe yaho, ya wainahe, wainahe, nahe, wainahe, nahe, wainahe. Na he he na ya ho, ya we na he ya ho, ya we na he. We na he na he, he na we na he, he na, ya we na he ya ho, ya we na he. This was a sun dance which his people had learned once from the Iroquois Indians of Caughnawaga. So it's really an Iroquois song interpreted by Huron. Then we passed on to other songs, songs which were danced for Sagamite feast. Sagamite is corn cooked with meat in a large cauldron in the open on a big fire, you see, around which the Indians were clustered, ready for a feast. In Oklahoma, among the same people, other branches of the same people, they call that Haminé instead of Sagamité. And then you see, the people would start singing gaily around the fire and in a ring mostly. They would sing, Ya Niko, Ya Niko, Ya No He, 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 Ya Niko, Ya Niko, Ya No He. Yaniko, Yaniko, Ya No He, 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 Yaniko, Yaniko, Ya No He. Another song of the war trail was Ala koi ayani no, ala koi ayani no, wetsi yane ayani no, ala koi ayani no, ala koi ayani no. Wetsi ane ayani no.